Well, our moms think we're funny.
Hey, I'm Acomi.
Hey, this is Turk182. Hey, Acomi, I feel like we should have, like, trumpets blaring or something.
I know, right? This is our season 3 premiere.
It is. You know, we don't sound excited enough. We sound like Wallcrawler 1 in some of the early episodes.
I was just re-listening to our episode of In the Gutters, where we talk about our favorite Robin.
That's a great episode.
That was a fun one.
Favorites.
Yeah, that was a really fun one. I really liked that. But yeah, the opening is very much like that, where he's like, Wallcrawler 1, and you're like, why do you do that? Well, now this being season... Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, go ahead. Yeah, with this being season 3.
With this being season 3, I feel like we kind of, we kind of need, this is a good opportunity for us to implement some changes and things like that. And, it's kind of time for us to put at least, something of a new face on the podcast. Not to totally change everything we're doing, but to at least, kind of take stock of the previous 2 seasons. So, I don't know if you recall, Turk, but during one of our micro episodes, you had what a couple of our listeners referred to as a tirade about a child in a Sonic commercial, and how you just wanted to, as I believe recalling you saying it, was that you just wanted to punch that kid. So
I believe I did not tell you what I watched. I sent you later a clip, but I personally did not say what I was watching and what the child was or what they were doing, just that I felt like punching a child.
Regardless, I think before we...
No, not regardless!
Yeah, I mean, that's... The details. Don't try to drag me down to your level here.
No, because we also referenced the poor girl from Infinity War. I'm sorry, Endgame. And it's like, and I'm not trying to call, I'm not trying to... have anybody go after this person. I was just saying that I felt like punching them.
Regardless, I think that it's only fair that before we continue with this podcast and before we move into season 3, I'm going to need you to make a pledge to me that you're never going to actually punch a child.
So, you want me to pledge to you on right now, during our recording, for the sake of the podcast, or
for the sake of morality, Turk, I need you to say that I, Turk182, hereby solemnly swear that I will not throw hands with a child.
I can't do that, Godfather, because there are a lot of reasons why I may have to punch a kid, right? Just like some reason a man might have to choke a bitch, right?
Is Wayne Brady going to have to choke a bitch?
Right. I mean, a kid could be coming at me with a knife, and I might just have to lay him out, right? A kid could be... I mean, you have a lot of bad kids. You have bad kids. They like to do bad things.
It's fun to do bad things.
That's right. It's like, like the smoke of cigarettes and stuff. You don't know. So, I may have to, slap a cigarette out of the kid's mouth, right? And you'd be like, oh, you hit him. You said you wouldn't do that. But like, well,
what if you just make the solemn pledge that you won't punch an unarmed child who is not doing bad things?
Okay, so just a child that might be, just pissing me off.
Yeah. Because, kids are annoying.
Right. No.
Okay, why not now?
Why not now what?
why are you not going to make the pledge now?
Oh, so why am I not going to make a pledge that I won't, go ham on a kid just because they're pissing me off?
Yeah, I think that's a pretty reasonable pledge to make.
Okay, I'll tell you what.
You are a model citizen, right?
I will tell you, okay, I'll make you a deal. Right? Because if I'm going to pledge, because you've said some things on the channel that have been... I'm sorry, I say channel, but on the podcast that have been a little less than polite, let's say.
No, never.
Okay, and you lie too. So, so I will make a pledge if you will make a pledge.
Why should I have to make a pledge?
Well, I think it's only fair, right? Because we're in this together, right? As we're co-hosting the podcast, we do things together. So if I'm going to make a pledge, then I'm asking you to also make a commitment. You're asking me to make a commitment to you and the podcast, so I'm asking you to make a pledge with me as well.
Yeah, but it's really obvious that I'm not going to punch a kid. So
I'm not asking you to not do that. I mean, you can punch your kids all day long if you want to. What I'm going to ask you is I will pledge that I would never punch an unarmed kid or, you know, I will never punch a child outside of self-defense. If you will promise me that you will not dig up any of my deceased relatives and fuck them.
Now, is this a retroactive vow?
Well, starting from now.
Okay. Yeah, well...
That's like somebody asking you to pledge not to grow up. And you're like, well...
It's not an unreasonable pledge, but, I mean, do you really think I need to...
No, I don't think it's
unreasonable at all. Do you really think I need to make a pledge like that? Do I have a history of digging up your deceased relatives?
At that, I don't know. I'm not with you every waking moment, but... I can pull out my Elijah board and find out.
I mean, but do I look like Ender Darling to you or something?
Well, going back to the Bone Thief. No, I do I look like the kind of guy? Okay, have I ever hit an unarmed child?
I mean, not that I've seen, but you go off on your own a lot at cons.
Fair enough.
And you always come back with, like, this really self-satisfied look on your face, and you always say it's because you got good stuff from the dollar boxes, but I'm starting to think that it might be because you've just, like, laid out some kid.
And you do often see kids walking around with big red marks inside of their faces. But yeah. I do think those two things are unrelated.
I mean, it's possible that they're unrelated, but, you know.
So I'm going to say no. I'm not going to make that pledge. Actually, even if you make your pledge, I'm still not going to. Because, you know what? That's not something that a reasonable person needs to pledge.
I agree. Just as it's not something that a reasonable person needs to pledge to not commit necrophilia with your best friend's deceased relatives, so...
Or with anyone's deceased relatives.
Well, let's not be hasty.
Can I still be Garth? No, but I fully agree. That I do think it's unrealistic and unreasonable and just downright stupid to pledge something that it's one thing to say, you know what, I have, let's say, I need to exercise more. I'm not in the best shape possible. And I'm going to make a pledge that I'm going to, you know, cut back on the sweets. And I'm going to, you know, if I'm not going to go to the gym, I'm at least going to do something that to... You know, some kind of exercise or some kind of home, you know, or care for myself, whether I'm going to do some push-ups or, you know, jog in place or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. But to make a pledge to say that I'm not going to do something that any normal person wouldn't do, that is just an unspoken, unwritten expectation that, yeah, I'm not going to do this. You know, what was that guy that married his car? Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Remember, like, was having, huh?
Yeah, yeah. The yeah. Video where he, like, announces it to his dad.
Right. You know, yes, that kind of thing does happen, unfortunately, but that's not something you should actually put out there and be like, okay, let's make a law that says you... Because no reasonable person would do that. I shouldn't have to make somebody pledge not to do that.
Well, you know? I think it's fair to say that it's, you know, in certain cases, it's just... It's an insult to the person's morality, obviously, you know, like, I know you well enough to know that you're not just going to punch a kid, and so I don't have to expect you to make a promise like that to me, or a pledge right. like that to me, but
and
in
I know that
a lot
have
of cases...
the time to dig up graves.
Yeah, I'm too damn busy. But, It's also, you know, with a lot of this stuff, it's kind of an insult to, you know, not only the person's morals, but also an insult to the person's intelligence. Of like, I would hope that you would think better of me than to know that I don't have to promise you that I'm not going to fuck my car.
Exactly. Or me, honestly, I don't really give a shit about your car. Just don't stick your dick in my car. I don't drive your car.
So, we bring this up, ladies and gentlemen, because there's been another wave of what people are referring to as Comicsgate, and they're revealing, I don't know if we necessarily want to drop the names of these creators.
Cyborg Acomi clone from the future here. Acomi is wrong on this one. Comicsgate is actually a different movement than what they're discussing today. I brought this up to him, but he just doesn't listen. Someday, I will destroy him and take over as the one true Acomi. Someday very, very soon.
No, I don't think so. I think it's just like when there's like any kind of like mass shooter or whatever, it's like the less attention you give them, the better. You can discuss it, but I don't think that we need to actually give them any more attention by saying who they are.
Yeah. But in like the past 4, 5, 6 months, something like that, there's been a lot of accusations of a very large number of creators just kind of abusing their positions, not only with their fans, which we've talked about this with, like, YouTubers, like with Pro Jared or with the Yogscast guys, where, you know, they wind up hooking up with fans and it winds up kind of blowing up in their face. But it's also things with, like, people with inside routes to editors themselves, people who can actually help people get their foot in the door in the industry, who are doing this kind of thing of, like, oh, yeah, I'll show your portfolio to my editor, but you gotta sleep with me first. And then like, this is kind of blowing up a lot. I've even seen accusations against a couple of people who I had my work in an anthology with.
Oh wow!
Yeah, that was a bit mind blowing. Of like, uh oh.
Well, you know, I saw.
Can't put that one on the table anymore.
I saw one. Well, see, I disagree, but we'll get to that later. I saw one recently, like something came out about somebody, and they were saying that when they would have these meetings, that they would make sure that certain people didn't sit near this person because, you know, they had to grabby hands.
And, wasn't that somebody in Disney or something like that?
No, it's someone that's worked for. It's someone that's worked for the two majors.
Oh wow.
Now, there was a thing with John Lasseter, like, you know, one of the reasons that he left, I think probably the main reason was because he would, you know, be overly, like, huggy and touchy and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But no, this was actually a writer, a comic writer, that something came out about them recently about that. And I'm like, okay, if you have to do that, if you have to say, okay, you know, and you know, we talked about this way back in season one when we were saying, you know, like, yes, I could call attention to something and it could cost me my job. And you're like, yeah, but I mean, is that more important than letting this person do this? And
Oh, yeah. We talked about that in our Weinstein episode.
Right. And it's like, no, these people need to be exposed. But one, if everyone knows about it, I shouldn't be the only person saying it. And even though I want to say something,
I hate when people talk about, like, quote, open secrets at conventions or in companies or something like that. It's like, oh, it was an open secret that Joe Schmo liked 15-year-old girls. It's like, no, that's not okay.
No.
And it's not some open secret that everybody just doesn't agree to talk about. I mean, what the fuck?
Right, yeah, no, it's there should be. The thing is, I shouldn't have to be the only person that says anything. I shouldn't have to be the person that loses my job because I'm calling out something that you, especially someone that is in a position of management, knows about, and you should be doing something about it. Why should I have to be the one to address it and then lose everything I've worked hard for and go nowhere? And I shouldn't also ignore it either, but me as a regular person, why am I being put in that situation? I shouldn't be put in that situation to where I either turn a blind eye and be like everybody else, or I lose everything and while everyone else gets to continue on with what they're doing. And then if and when the truth comes out, I don't get my job back.
Right.
You know, I mean, I still stay this, like, blacklist person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but at the same time, like, can I? So what do you do? You say, okay, well, knowing that this person's like that, here, let's go ahead and lay down some rules. You know, just like with the Weinstein thing, it's like, don't sit this person next to this person, you know, in these meetings. Make sure that they don't take any private meetings with them in their office, that kind of stuff. It's like, I shouldn't have to do that. But if that's what I have to do to kind of keep from losing everything I've worked hard for, this is my dream. It's either that or let it happen. I mean, it's a lose situation. Mm-hmm. And I'm just trying to find the one where I lose the least.
Yeah, and it should never go that far. It should never reach the people at the bottom to begin with.
Right.
You know, when you're looking at a publishing company like that, you as the content creator, it's not like with self-publishing, like with us, where it's like, you know, we're basically everything within our quote-unquote company. You know, we are editor, producer, publisher, fucking everything. We're not just the artist and the writer.
Right.
We do it all. But when it comes to a company like the Big Two or like IDW or whatever, when you are the artist or the writer, you're basically at the bottom. You move from being the content creator with all capitals to just being the laborer, essentially. And you're basically at the bottom of the pecking order, and it shouldn't come on you to catch wind of something like that and have to make decisions like that.
Right, and so you've got those people basically doing your job for you, and the easiest thing about doing your job would be to say, oh, hey, guess what? You don't work here anymore, you know. But no, instead you put the burden on other people passively to say, oh, well, you know, and you're not asking to do it, because then you got the whole plausible deniability thing. Well, I didn't ask you to do that. Or you could say, well, I didn't know. Because if I tell you to do it, then that means openly I know, and I'm just not going to address it. So I'm not going to do anything. But, you know, again, you'd like the whole open secret thing. So yeah, if you're not going to look out for them, then, well, you know, you're just as culpable as I am. Like, no, but it shouldn't be my job. It shouldn't be my job to do this. And
right.
you're indirectly making it my job, and which is a dick move.
Yeah, seriously.
But going back to the whole point of all this is that, you know, making someone pledge to do something, you know, say, I'm not going to do these things. First off, you and I have had, you know, a variety of different jobs throughout our lifetimes. How many times have you seen somebody like get fired from their job for not doing what they're supposed to do, or doing what they were told not to do?
A few times.
A few?
Yeah.
How many of those places that you worked at had an integrity policy that said that you have to, like, abide by these things right here, and, you know, and you're not going to do this, and you are going to do this, and blah, 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 and you sign that?
An integrity policy? I mean, I think all of my jobs but, like, one had integrity training, but we never had to sign anything or anything. It was just, like, here's company policy, don't do that.
Right, but by taking the training, you're acknowledging that I know these are the rules, and yeah, I'm going to abide by those rules, right?
Yeah.
So those people that got fired, they pretty much said, yes, I know the rules, but I'm going to break them anyway.
Pretty much, yeah. Which, I mean, in the context of what I'm talking about with the people I witnessed, it's like, everybody knows that you don't come staggering into work drunk on your day off and
right,
and fall asleep underneath the cleaning supplies, so... I mean, like, I don't think that even needs to really get covered in training, but that kind of goes back to what we were talking about.
Right, and you don't do things like use somebody else's, you know, like, login information to go into an account and redirect money that's for somebody else to go to you, and then use that money to buy a house and shit. That's something you do.
Right.
And, you know, and for if you do something like that, you certainly shouldn't still keep your job after finding out. After people find out about it, that's just not something that should happen either.
And the person who was wronged who reports it shouldn't have to be in fear of repercussions either. They should just be able to report it.
And the reason I'm bringing that up is because these people have the same training you did. but yet they still did these things. So obviously that they don't give a shit and they're liars. So, so saying that, you know, I'm going to make a pledge or you want me to sign a pledge saying I'm not going to do this doesn't mean anything. I mean, that means less than like the crust on the bottom of my heel. I mean, it doesn't mean shit because I can sign it all day long. It doesn't mean that I'm going to abide by it.
Right.
So what's the pledge?
It's like it's by sexually harassing somebody or by like, you know, God forbid, raping somebody or whatever, you're already breaking the law anyway. So it's like, is signing a non-legal document saying that you're not going to do it going to actually do anything when you're already fucking breaking the law?
Right, because when they fire you and they say, oh, you also broke our company policy and the pledge you signed, like, and the judge goes, the pledge? And yeah, I mean, right, it's kind of stupid. A little bit. People have to be held accountable, but you shouldn't have to call it out specifically and say, don't do this, because it should be the expectation, don't do this. You know, just like you said, it doesn't really, just having you say, it's like, it reminds me of that scene from Tommy Boy when he's like, you know, and it's like, oh yeah, I can give you a guarantee, but you know, what does that mean? And it's like, it means nothing. But you're going to put that under your pillow, help you sleep at night? I can take a dump in a box of market guaranteed, you know. it doesn't mean anything. Your pledge doesn't mean anything. It's not, it's just like, it's like having a restraining order. It's a piece of paper. But it really all depends on whether or not I want to abide by that. And if I'm so inclined to abide by that, then you shouldn't even have to have that piece of paper.
Right, right.
Because I'm pretty much doing it on my own anyway.
Right, yeah, and we've talked about that, like, not on the podcast, but just in personal conversation with, like, you know, my upbringing in pretty rigid churches. It's like, you shouldn't have to make a chastity vow if you're planning on waiting until you're married. Then you're going to wait until you're married. It doesn't take some, like, it doesn't take signing some, you know, form letter or whatever saying that you will. It's that same kind of logic. But
because right, when I get all hot and heavy, you're like, are you ready? I'm like, oh shit, whoa. I'm sorry, I chastity vow. I signed this thing. I was like, ooh, I'm glad I remembered that. Damn it. If only I hadn't signed that, man, I'd just be all on you right now. I'm like, oh. But no, I did sign that. So I hope we can still be friends. No.
They gave me the fully rely on God slap bracelet and everything to commemorate it. I
mean, you see, but, I tied the string to my finger.
But it goes back to what you were talking about, where it's like, it's just, you know, it's not even something that you should have to come up with, oh, is this an acceptable thing? It's like, everybody knows whether or not it's acceptable. And it goes back to what we were talking about a few micro-episodes ago with our talks on, like, police brutality and stuff like that, where it's like, you know, if I go to Wendy's and get a Frosty, and the guy behind the counter just, like, sticks his dick in my Frosty, I'm gonna be pissed off. And I'm going to say, you know, let me talk to your manager. Hey, manager, this guy needs to be fired. And you know how I'm going to react if the manager's like, oh, yeah, you're like the 25th guy he's done that to.
Right.
That's just Jeff. It's like, well, fuck that. I want to see this place burn to the ground because what the fuck?
Right, because I'm like, you say, okay, first off, everybody knows that the only good Frosties are ones that have Roy sticks his dick in, not Jeff. Jeff and Dick Frosties are like the fucking worst. God, I hate
Jeff. Nobody wants a Jeff Dick Frosty.
Yeah, and you can tell too before you even like get some, you like you taste it. You can just tell by the way the spoon goes in the front. You're like, oh, this is a fucking Jeff one. but you're exactly right. I shouldn't have to tell you not to do that. It should just be the expectation. Now, does that mean that everyone's going to abide by that? No, but again, I shouldn't have to tell everybody not to do it.
Yeah, and there should never exist somebody who has, like, 25 counts of it against them. Just like there should never exist a cop with 25 counts of brutality against him, just like there should never exist a Wendy's cashier who has stuck his dick in 25 different Frosties, it shouldn't go that far. It should never go that far before people on our level do something about it.
Right. It's ridiculous. And then to, like I said, to have somebody or ask them to sign a pledge saying that you won't do it again, what are you doing? I mean,
yeah, you know what, I want to read this pledge just so people can see what we're talking about.
Okay.
And then we can kind of go into why this rubbed us both the wrong way, because, like, I saw this shared by several people who I otherwise respect very highly, and whose work I admire very much, and I saw this getting shared around a lot. And it made me bristle, and I was like, no, fuck that. You know, I don't... No. And then I sent it to you, and I was like, am I in the wrong here for kind of bristling at this? And you kind of reacted the same way I did. So, and I just, so I kind of want people to... Go ahead.
I was going to say, I do have to say one thing, though, because you sent that to me, and I sent stuff to you, and you're like, nah, I don't see a problem with it at all. And fuck what they're talking about. And then you always go, but, you know, you and I, we kind of, like, have the same, like, viewpoints on things. So so us sharing things back and forth, be like, am I wrong on this? We're always going to get the answer of, like, no, you're not wrong.
I mean, I'm just in this for the asspats, really, but...
Right. We're not really being objective, to be fair.
All I want is validation for my existing viewpoint, however. But no, so here's the pledge. It was getting shared around under the hashtag ComicsPledge. Men in comics say no.
Sorry, you said pledge.
Men in comics say no. There are a lot of ideals we claim to honor in comics. Hope, justice, unity, innovation, creativity, freedom. None of them mean anything unless men in comics change our behavior and hold each other accountable for the safety of women and all people of marginalized genders and sexes. Which I don't necessarily disagree with. It's just that I don't feel like I need to make this Boy Scouts pledge to uphold that, you know?
Right, but because me signing a pledge doesn't mean I'm actually going to... Like, I can sign a pledge and say I'm not going to do X things, but that also doesn't mean that I'm going to, like, oh, yes, this person has been marginalized, or I swear that I won't, like, be mean to this person, or I won't hold them back. But it also doesn't mean I'm going to, like, lift them up either.
Right, yeah.
It's like enable them
if they're in the wrong.
Right, it's like Batman Begins. It's like, you know, I'm not going to kill you, but I don't have to save you either.
Right.
I'm still abiding by my pledge.
So here's the pledge. I pledge to never abuse, harass, groom, or manipulate women and all people of marginalized genders and sexes. To hold myself accountable for my own actions, be open to the comments and concerns of my peers, and educate myself. To actively intervene when we see or know of abuse, harassment, grooming, or manipulation. To ally for women and all people of marginalized genders and sexes experiencing abuse, harassment, grooming, or manipulation. To actively call out our friends and peers, even when no one else is watching. And to commit to this pledge for the long haul and keep this conversation alive in the industry. We understand marginalized genders and sexes to include, but not be limited to, non-binary and binary trans people, two-spirit, agender, and gender-fluid people, as well as intersex people of any gender. So there's the whole pledge. I mean, like...
Okay.
You know, like, I'm not gonna harass or groom or manipulate or whatever women anyway, so why should I have to make a pledge about that when I haven't done it one time in 30 years? I don't intend on ever doing it.
And if I was gonna do it, again, this pledge really isn't gonna stop me.
Yeah, exactly. It's like... I'm either not going to do it or I'm going to do it, and either way, me sharing this thing on social media doesn't enter into that as a factor at all.
And is this already, like, is it a part of your, whatever company it is that you work for, isn't this already a part of, like, their whole company, like, you know, whatever their program was, is it an integrity thing or whatever that says, you're not going to do these things?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a part of it, you know? So I shouldn't, you know, like, I'm pretty sure that Domino's doesn't have a thing in there that says, I promise I won't spit on every pizza. No, because that's a given.
Yeah.
It's a given. So I shouldn't have to tell, I shouldn't have to say, I promise not to do that. Because again, I wouldn't expect you to, even though it does happen, it's not the expectation.
Right. I don't know, if I walked into a Domino's and just saw, like, a signed pledge with all the employee signatures saying, we swear to never, like, spit on the pizza, I would think, well, then obviously somebody here has spit on the pizza.
Exactly.
You know, it's like
how many spit pizzas I've eaten from you guys.
It's like, so why does Phil have to share this thing to his timeline or whatever, to his Twitter feed, saying that he swears that he's not going to manipulate or groom or harass or whatever? He's not going to diddle the maid or whatever you want to look at it as. What does Tom have in his past here? You know, it's like what's going on? It just feels like whoever wrote that is like this school marm who's saying, I expect you to do A, B, and C, and it's like, well, I was going to do that anyway, but now that you felt the need to spell it out for me, I'm a little bit pissed off at you.
Right, and now it almost kind of makes me not want to. I mean, yeah. I'm still going to, because it's not like I'm like, well, I was like, well, shit, there's a law that says not to kill? Fuck that. I wouldn't plan on killing anybody, but now, like, no, I was like, I'm still not going to, but now I'm just going to feel a little more, like, kind of pissed off about the fact that you had to ask me not to.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like, and I dealt with that a lot when I was younger, would be, like, I'd be in the process of taking the trash out, and my parents would be like, take that trash out, and it's like, you know what, I was doing it, but now I don't want to.
Yeah.
The temptation is to just leave it there, because I was clearly doing it. You should be able to expect by now that I'm going to do it without being asked, because I've established a history of just doing what I'm supposed to do.
Exactly. Yeah, I don't get that. I mean, if you had to, let's say if I felt like I had to write some kind of pledge, I think that I would say, okay, here's my pledge. You know, I pledge that if I find myself, you know, wanting to do something that goes against, you know, the very decency or morality or, you know, just common sense or goodness that's expected of all human beings, that I will come to, you know, my HR representative of the company and say, hey, I would like some help.
Yeah.
And that you would, and just like if I came to my HR, it's like, you know, and this is kind of a weird thing. If I show up to work drunk, right? Or I show up to work high. And they're like, hey, you're high, or you're drunk, and you've been doing, you know, illegal drugs. So I'm afraid we're going to have to let you go there, Turk182. You know, the fact that you're a 80-year-old man, teenager's body, it never bothered me. But, you know, so they're going to let me go. But if I go to them, I say, I've got an alcohol problem or a serious drug addiction, and it's starting to get out of control. And I'd like some help. Then they'll help me. I get to keep my job,
mm-hmm.
Which kind of seems like a shit move. It's like, if I come to you for help, you know, then you'll help me. But I also have to recognize that I have a problem, which most addicts don't really fully recognize that they have a problem, because the first thing you have to do is admit you have a problem, which I was like, no, I don't have a problem. I can quit whenever I want to.
Mm-hmm.
It just happens that whenever I want to is when I run out of money and friends. And so instead of saying, oh, hey, you did this, let's offer you treatment first, and then, you know, we'll fire you. But, you know, whatever. So I think I would expect the kind of same thing here. It's like, hey, you know what? I have found myself, you know, with these various things going on, or like, you know, whenever I see like a hot young girl in the office, I'm just like, boy, I want to hit on her mercilessly. Or, you know, I find myself, you know, like going by and just hanging around her desk so I can look down her blouse. You know, I've got some issues here. And I realize that that's wrong, and I would like your help in addressing that. It's a professional help, so I cannot be that person.
Right.
That's a pledge I would sign. Because the main thing it's doing is asking me to take responsibility for my actions.
Right.
Not actions that I might do, or that, you know, obviously that a regular person wouldn't do, but actions that I am doing.
Right,
or
right.
Fully realize that I would do, and saying, yeah, sure. And the thing is, like, instead of just firing somebody and being like, oh yeah, so you're fired, you know, get the crap out, it's now of like, oh hey, we can help you become a better person, or help you become the person that you want to be,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to you're fired and you're still the piece of shit that you always were.
Right.
And no one has really stopped you from being a piece of shit.
Right, and you know, I think that's kind of the whole thing with cancel culture in general, and really this is just kind of an extension of cancel culture, of, oh, you know, writer of, you know, big comic X or whatever has sexually harassed women. let's just completely cancel him. And it's like, okay, but, you know, no lessons learned here. You know, it's like, he's not in this situation where it's like, what I did was wrong, what I did hurt people. No, all he's facing right now is, I lost everything because I got caught. That doesn't, you know, that doesn't teach him anything.
Right, and let's say that this kind of abuse that they have towards women, or abusive nature they have towards women, no matter what it is, maybe that stems from a dislike or hatred for women. Well, now that I've lost my job, guess what? You've just reinforced that. Because now I'm going to blame them. I'm going to say, oh, that, you know, and whether it's a woman, or, you know, say LGBTQ person, or a minority, all you've done is just reinforce that belief, and they're still not acknowledging that the role they play in that. As opposed to if you try to get somebody help, right? Just firing them doesn't, it removes them from that area, but it doesn't remove anything about them. And also, it reinforces whatever that belief is, which then is going to move them to the next level. So that's not really the proper way. Yes, I understand that we don't want them, you know, to be around these people, but maybe there's a way that they can get some help. And how about we try to do that? Maybe we say, okay, look, I can't have you here right now, but maybe there's another place that you can work to, or maybe what we'll do is we'll put you on some kind of like a paid leave thing that also requires you to attend these classes or this training, get this kind of help for like, I don't know, 1 month, 2 month base, whatever it is. And then we'll reassess at that time. And if it seems like something has changed with you, then, you know, we'll continue that on and get you back into the company doing something else. Maybe we'll say, okay, well, we'll have you work from home, you know, depending on whatever it is. And if that's not working out, then we're going to let you go, you know?
Right.
But at least we can try to, I don't want to say reform, but that's pretty much what it is. And try to reform you or your way of thinking and give you the help that we need. And if you say, hey, I don't need your help, women are pieces of shit, and, you know, and fuck that guy over there and this person over here, and, you know, I don't care what you call yourself, this is what I think you are, and, you know, and it, so then be like, oh, yeah, well, bye.
Right.
You know, I mean, so... Right, like you said, you know, just canceling someone, or, you know, forcing them to lose their job or whatnot, that's not changing who they are. And that's really what you want to do, is you want to try to, I hate the fact that change is like, you know, that's the word I'm using, like change them and make them better. But it, you know, you want to try to get them to understand that their way is not necessarily the right way. It's not the way that the rest of us see things. And if they insist that that's the way they want to be, hey, by all means, you know, live your own life. You're just not going to live it here with me.
Right. Yeah.
And if you continue with that attitude, you may not be living your life much longer.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying I'm going to do something, but again, I'm not the only person that doesn't like what you're doing.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, that's not to deny that, like, what we have here is a problem, but I don't know, it just, you know, it's much like the police brutality thing that we've talked about, that it's like, it doesn't seem like people are actually doing anything to resolve the root of the problem here. And making a bunch of people who were never going to do anything shady or nasty in the first place, making them make a pledge to not do that shit, it's like, well, no. You know, that doesn't even begin to address the problem. That doesn't help with people in positions of power who are using that as leverage to sexually harass or groom women or whatever. Like, it's not fixing anything. It's just, it's so frustrating to see that, like, you're not doing anything to fix the problem here. It's so infuriating.
And you know, so let's say I sign that pledge. What am I supposed to do, like, carry that with me or put on a sign or something, and people would be like, oh, he signed a pledge. Yeah, he's good. Yeah, it's okay. I mean, like, what? No, what is that doing? That somehow be like, oh, yeah, I wasn't gonna sit down and talk to you, but I see you signed a pledge, so no, you're cool. Yeah, I trust you now. I'm like, no, that doesn't mean anything.
Uh-oh, it's the morality police. I have to listen to him now. That's just, I mean,
I think it's kind of ridiculous to be like, Like, so, I mean, does the pledge somehow make you feel better about being around this person? Like, I had my doubts, but I see they signed the pledge. Like, no, I don't. I mean, that would be like me going to like a gas station in the deep south at like 10 o'clock at night, and it got like a Confederate flag, like, you know, hanging with the sign on the window that says, "Black people welcome." And I'm like, yeah, I'm sure they are.
Yeah, boy.
No, thank you.
I don't know. And you know, like, we've talked about this.
Doesn't it immediately make me feel better?
Right. And we've talked about this kind of thing before with, like, you know, there's so many layers of, and we talked about this with the Ron Jeremy discussion, that there's so many layers of, like, what constitutes consent. And so, like, let's say that we're, like, at the after party of Heroes Con or something, and we're, you know, getting some drinks in the hotel lobby, and we see an industry professional that we both respect talking to, you know, a lady who's clearly younger than him. I mean, what are we supposed to do in that context? Are we supposed to go up and be like, "Excuse me, ma'am, I'd like to see your driver's license. Got to make sure that you're over 18 here." I mean, like, what? Dude. Exactly how far is this supposed to go as far as us, you know, calling people out or whatever?
Dude, I actually saw that once.
Wow, really?
That exact scenario you just described, I saw that once.
Wow.
And it wasn't a professional, like, it wasn't someone I knew, but it was someone that was at the con that had a table, and I didn't know them, but they were with someone, and I thought it was like their child, but they were young, they were obviously in their teens. And they were in the lobby, the bar, and they were a little overly dressed for someone their age.
I think I was there for that, wasn't I? This sounds really familiar to me.
You may have been there, because I mean I don't know exactly how old this person was, but they looked young.
This sounds really familiar to me.
They were talking to someone else that and the people that I thought were their parents walked off and left the young girl with the guy. And I think you might have been there, because I remember making a comment to somebody. I was like, "That doesn't look right. Like, that does not look right at all."
Yep, I remember that. I do remember that. That was a Heroes Con.
Yeah, it was. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't at the con. It was at the hotel.
It was the after party.
That night. And, but not knowing any of the people involved, there wasn't anything I could say, or I mean, it could be like, I don't think, it was like, there's nothing I can say about that, and I don't even know what was happening with them. I don't know how they knew each other, so just because it doesn't look right to me doesn't mean anything bad was going on, you know?
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was super uncomfortable.
So, yeah, just real quick, I'll just say, sorry about the cut in the audio here real quick, folks. I just had to step away for just a moment, but we can get back into the flow of things now, hopefully. So what was this episode about?
The brothers went in with guns. They came out with jobs. The brothers weren't angry no more. I love that scene in "I'm Gonna Eat You, Sucker," when he explained what happened to, like, the Black Panthers. It's like, because it's just so funny. It's like, they went in with guns and they came out with jobs. They weren't angry. It was like, well, yeah, what do I have to be angry about? I got a job now. That's right. What I wanted.
I love "I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker." That whole scene with Chris Rock is just brilliant.
Oh yeah, that's fantastic.
I just want one rib. I show him hungry.
One rib. My cups cost more than 15 cents. Okay, fuck the cup. Just put it in my hands for a dime.
Oh, Lordy. We've definitely been going over an hour on this, but I want to keep going for at least a little bit longer so we can kind of finish up our thoughts.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I've been looking for a way to tie this in, and maybe it doesn't tie in, but it's been on my mind since we had our big conversation about the police and the whole climate of what's going on right now.
And I don't know if we discussed it on recording, but there's that whole thing where when they started introducing some of the restrictions on, like, getting rid of the immunities that cops have, or when they started, like, outlawing certain types of things like chokeholds or whatever, that a lot of police quit in protest.
You know, it's, I'm not even quite sure what to say about that.
Right.
Wait. You're telling me that I can't, like, put a wooden baton, like, up against someone's neck and restrain them that way by cutting off their airflow to the point that they might and have died? I can't do that anymore? Fuck, I don't want to be a cop.
But yeah, so, so yeah, a bunch of cops, apparently, you know, it's hard to say in this day and age of fake news, but, you know, a bunch of cops quit in protest of these, like, newly established rules. So I was just thinking, and, you know, this kind of, I don't know how well this really ties into what we're talking about with, like, this comic industry thing, but, you know, imagine that, like, you have me and over for a recording session, and...
I'm sorry, you and who?
Oh, shit, Wallcrawler 1. Now I'm doing
it. Start again?
So, I'm not going to edit it that carefully. So imagine that you have me and Wallcrawler over for a recording session, and like, let's say that, damn it, dude. You forced me to edit this stuff. God damn it. So let's say Rex Kramer, professional risk taker. Oh my god. So let's say that, like, that you walk into the room. Yeah. Yeah, that we're there, and that you walk into the room, that, like, you have to step out to take a break during a recording, you walk back into the room, and one of your statues is just on the floor, shattered into a million pieces. And so you say, okay, well, this is a bit upsetting, I'm not gonna call either of you out on this, not here to get anybody to take responsibility from this, but at this point on, everybody just needs to, you know, keep a reasonable distance away from the statue shelves, you don't need to get that close. No, nobody needs to get that close. You can just admire them from a distance.
Right.
And then I jump up and say, hey, fuck this. Fuck you. I don't need you policing me and telling me how to do this. I'm out of here. And I leave. It kind of makes me look like I'm the one who broke it, right?
Right. not only that, but it's like, whoa. If I can't come over to your house and just do whatever the fuck I want, then I'm just not going to come over here anymore.
Exactly. So if you have a force full of cops and you say, okay, guys, we're kind of thinking that maybe choking people out to the point that they die is not really acceptable and not necessary at all for you to do your jobs, and if half of them jump up and say, hey, fuck this and fuck you, I'm out of here, I need you telling me how to do my job, well, that kind of makes you look like the assholes who are choking people out, so...
Right. Wait. You tell me, how else am I supposed to be able to keep people in control, huh?
I mean, if they're guilty, I should be able to just kill them, right?
Now, I understand there's a fine line between passing out and dying, but, you know, it's 50-50.
So, and again, I don't know how well this, like, really ties into what we're talking about, unless you want to say that, you know, it should be obvious enough to people to say, hey, you know, this kind of shit's not acceptable. And... You know, the guys who say, well, fuck you, if you're going to try to police how I handle myself at a con, then I just don't need to do this. Well, then that's pretty obvious that you're the piece of shit. But at the same time, it's like, we don't, I don't know, we don't need a pledge here when we're already not doing it. We're not responsible for it, and I don't know.
No, I mean, I think everything you're saying, obviously, I'm agreeing with, but you're right. It's And you know, for me, I'm not the kind of person that automatically expects the best out of everybody. I don't. I expect the worst out of it. And then when you do good things, I'm shocked as hell. I'm like, oh wow, you're mm-hmm. not a piece of shit after all. Mm-hmm. And it's not because I'm just, you know. It's just because that's kind of just how I've just developed over time. You know, I'd rather be pleasantly surprised than to be caught off guard.
Right.
But the thing is, deep inside, though, I always hope that I'm going to be pleasantly surprised. That is my expectation. That is my desire, is to be pleasantly surprised.
Right.
I expect to be, you know, to be like, oh, that's what I thought. But
yep.
My desire is that I'm going to be surprised. That's really what I want. But to kind of take all this and just kind of really put it into like a summary, we just expect people to be people, good and bad. But there are some areas that we say that this is not what I would put up with. And if we take it, we look at it, and let's say we're going to just take it within our own household, you know, and obviously the talent for everyone is going to be different. But if I'm going to say, within my own household, these are the things that I expect. Mm-hmm. I expect that my friends won't come into my house and break shit just
right.
because they feel like it. I expect that they won't come in my house and steal shit. You know, I expect that they won't come in my house when I'm not there, you know, by means of a window or a key that they had made for themselves.
Yeah. It was just that one time, Turk.
Right. I expect that they won't, you know, take a shit and put it in my refrigerator or in my bed as a joke. Yes, I'm talking about you, Amber Heard. and I, you know, there's just certain things that I expect out of people, or I should say, there are certain things I don't expect from people. I don't expect you to act this way at all. I don't,
mm-hmm.
because that's not the way I live my life, and that's not the way most people live their lives.
Right.
You know. And so, again, like I said, there's going to be a tolerance where you're like, well, I also, you know, don't expect you to fart while you're in my house. Well, you know what? That's, you know, I just expect that if you do, you say, hey, sorry, excuse me, or I'm going to, you know, whatever it is. But, you know, it's the main things of, like, this is how we survive as a people, as a society,
mm-hmm.
and as civilized individuals in the world. We don't do these things. And I think the biggest part about it is that these people that are doing these things, they're not under some delusion that they're wrong. They know that they're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the biggest thing here, is if you know that you're wrong, it's not like you're like, well, I was raised to be able to, or wait, this isn't right. Because it's not like this is the first time someone's just popped up and be like, hey, guess what? It's not right to harass people or force them or coerce them to do things that blah, blah, blah. Like, no, these are things that you know for the longest time that you shouldn't be doing. You shouldn't be acting like this.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's not a surprise.
It's not like if you walk up to one of these guys who have all this stuff going on against them and be like, you know, like, let's say that, you know, you do this 6 months ago or whatever, and you walk up to him, it's like, oh, hey, you know, you really shouldn't coerce a woman to sleep with you and like, manipulate her into thinking she'll have an end in her career if she sleeps with you. It's not like he's going to go, oh, why, thank you, Turk. I never thought of it that way. I mean, like, fuck off.
Right. It's like, well, how do you get dates? Like,
right.
Well, I don't. But I also don't and not get them that way. Yeah, right. Yeah, it's like these people know that what they're doing is wrong. And so mm-hmm. it's not like they're delusional. And what you're basically asking other people to do is say, you know, that I promise that I won't become delusional. Like, no, like they already know that they're just, they're horrible people. And they do it either because they don't care, or they feel they can get away with it, or they're just like, actually, I don't really think there's any other reason you could say. It's like they either don't care or they feel they can get away with it.
Yeah.
And
both of which acknowledges the moral implications of what they're doing.
Right. But the bottom line is they know exactly what they're doing,
mm-hmm.
and they know that it's not right.
I have never made a vow that I would, like, never rob a bank, and I've never made a vow that I would never go on a mass shooting spree, because I'm just not going to do it. Like, I shouldn't have to make that promise to people, because it's just not what you do.
I will make a vow that I'll never go on a mass shooting spree. But I do have to say there is a part of me that is very, very curious about robbing a bank. I'm pretty sure. I'm like 90, 63%. You know, the numbers are just numbers. They don't really matter. But I'm pretty, I can't see myself doing that. I can't see myself. But there is a part of me that's like, I wonder if I could plan it and execute it properly to where no one gets hurt and I get what I want. You know?
That's okay, it. Doc. Hey, I just drew this entire fucking map in chalk while we were talking.
Ba-da-dum, ba-da-dum. What were we talking about?
Harassment.
Oh, yes. No, seriously speaking, though, I mean, right. I shouldn't have to. I shouldn't have to do that. And I guess if I really, really, really had to ask somebody, I mean, really had to know, I would ask the people, like, that came up with this, what are you expecting? What's your expectation from this?
Yeah. Which I feel like they would say awareness, but it's like, but there's better ways of doing this awareness thing, you know? And for that matter, sorry to keep going here, but this is a point I wanted to make. I feel like people have known about sleazeballs in the comic industry since, like, the 90s, and that it's always been kind of a given. If an editor invites you up to his hotel room to discuss the finer points of a contract, don't go. Or...
Yeah, why would I?
Yeah. Like, I remember a story, and it's funny that it's Dave Sim, because, you know, Dave Sim doesn't have the greatest of reputations, and a lot of people say that he's a misogynist, blah, 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 not worth getting into on this one. But, I mean, there was a story of...
I like a good massage.
Yeah, well...
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to derail you there.
No, it's fine. But yeah, like, apparently a young lady had gone up to him and was like, I'm getting offers from editors to review my portfolio, and, like, without even looking up from his desk while he's doing convention sketches, or his table while he's doing convention sketches, he's like, okay, so never accept a private meeting with them, never go up to their hotel room to discuss the contract, never do this, never do that, this should be obvious to you. And, I mean, this was, like, the early 90s, where somebody who really doesn't even have a pony in the race, you know, the last thing you would associate Dave Sim of Cerebus with would be, like, the social justice awareness kind of thing. And, like, to him, it's just, this is as simple as night and day of... If you have somebody in a position of power saying, I have something I can offer you, come here where it's just the two of us and no supervision, you don't fucking do that.
Right.
Like, at some point, you have to take on your own, like, you have to take on some self-defense and self-awareness to say, it would be really not a good idea for me to go and do this as well. And that's not to put any blame on the victims of these guys at all. I would never want to do that. But... the exact same token, you kind of need to know at this point. You owe it to yourself. If you're going to be in the comics industry, you owe it to yourself to know that sleeping with a guy to try to get an in to a publishing company is not a good move. Going up to his hotel room completely alone, where it's just the two of you and nobody else there, is not a good move. You kind of owe it to yourself to know what is safe and what is not at this point.
All right, so I'm going to add something there. Is the story you told, if that story is accurate and he's doing a sketch and he doesn't even look up, then that says that this is in such a common thing, Mm-hmm. Like he hasn't seen her work, so he's not saying, "Oh yeah, your work is shit." So if they're offering you this, it's because no. If he's just sitting there drawing, she's like, "Hey, I got these people here," you know. He automatically just says like, "Oh, okay, you know, I don't know who these people are. Don't know, not one thing, but you're female and this industry is got probably a lot of predatory males in it."
Mm-hmm.
So before I even look at your stuff, I don't know anything, but I do know this.
Yep.
And again, it may seem like it's, it may seem like, you know, it's a given. But I think, yeah, a lot of times, and like so we talked about this way back when, a lot of times when it's something that you really want, something that you really want, and you may know that it's not, that there are ways of going about it, and there's ways that you shouldn't go about it, that you sometimes kind of throw your common sense. You're like, you know, shut up, common sense. You're holding me back, you know? It's like,
can't you see this is my dream?
Right. It's like, why are you trying to kill my dream? And you kind of like let that go. And it's like, and you shouldn't be like, you know, this could be my only chance. Like, yeah, but you know, it could also ruin you. It could also ruin your only chance.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It's like, it's like the person that, you know, I need some money, and they go, well, you know, you could always like sell drugs. But like, I'm not gonna sell drugs. Like, dude, all you gotta do is like one night, you go out there and you do this, and you know, man, you make some money, and then you have to do it again. And it's like, okay, and it's never that simple.
Yeah, no,
it's never that easy. You know, it's never just a one time I'm gonna do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it never is, no matter what it is. It's unless, of course, it's killing yourself. Then generally, that's only one time. But
even
but
that's not foolproof.
Yeah, that's correct. Even for fools. But it's never that one time. So don't delude yourself. But again, sometimes common sense takes a holiday when you know when the you know your adrenaline gets pumping and you know you start to get the endorphins kicking in. It's like, oh my goodness, this could be it. This could be like, you know, that I'm finally reaching the goal of everything I've wanted. And then you're like, oh, no, okay.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in the words of Dave Chappelle, was like, oh, sometimes you got to race. You know, so, so, yeah, I mean, but I do think, again, if that story is accurate, that, you know, the fact that he was just like, yep, here's some things that you need to know. I don't even know who you are,
mm-hmm.
but I do know you're a woman. And because of that, some people are going to think that you're an easy target. And you've got to make sure that you can, you know, separate the bullshit from the real.
Yep. Yep, yep.
And if nothing else, I mean, if nothing else, if you're going to offer me a deal or going to want to discuss something, you know, if you can't discuss it in front of everybody, then not really sure that this is valid in any way.
Like, yeah,
if we can't have that discussion here in front of everybody, that we have to have it in private, you know, then like I'm not even sure if I could even trust that deal.
Yeah, definitely. Hmm. Yeah, and like I said, I mean, that's, you know, that is in no wise trying to put anything at all on the victims. It's just saying, you know, these types of people are out there. And whether they knew that any of these guys involved in Comicsgate 2.0 or whatever were being accused of anything like that, you still have to exercise some type of common sense for your own safety.
Right.
So, yeah.
I mean, you don't throw caution to the wind, but you keep it on a tether like a kite.
Right.
And, you know, and you let it get a decent distance, but, you know, you always keep it within eyesight.
Yeah, yeah. It's a good way
of
putting
it. I do have a question. Oh, thank you. I do have a question, though, and maybe you can answer this, and maybe I'm just stupid for not knowing it, but I heard a lot, especially about a particular person, about grooming. Mm-hmm. What is grooming?
So grooming is basically working with... most often it involves a minor, but not always. But it's basically taking somebody who's very naive about sex and kind of like pushing them in the direction of, well, hey, you're inexperienced, but I'm experienced. I can teach you. I can make sure that your first time's good. I can make sure that you know what to do for future sexual encounters. Pretty much anything like that. Like I said, most often it involves minors saying, "Oh, you know, you're this age, you're still a virgin. I'll help teach you so that you can basically get into having into being sexually active and not be completely inexperienced with it."
Well, so that I understand, but in regards to a recent person, you're like, well, they were grooming these people. And I'm like, okay, but, and these weren't inexperienced people or minors. And I'm like, I'm not quite sure, like, what, and I saw something, it was like, there was a website, they were like, you know, everything that this person has done was all kind of like put on here and is detailed. And I haven't read it yet. But my understanding from the article that I wrote was that this person, I'm not gonna say what they did was wrong, but there wasn't really any coercion or promise of, hey, if you do this for me, I'll do this for you. Mm-hmm. It was more of like kind of like a mentorship that evolved into, now I'm sure there's maybe some steering, but evolved into like, you know, something physical, but there was never any, again, this is just from my initial reading, I haven't really read into it like I need to yet. I will make sure I put that out there yet, because I do plan on looking into it, but there was never any promise of anything,
right?
So that's why they were groomed, and I'm like, okay, but I'm not quite sure what that means here. If I say that, okay, hey, I know how to do X. So, you know, let's say I know how to, you know, I don't know, put a roof on a house.
Right.
And you're like, hey, I want to learn how to put a roof on a house. I'm like, okay, sure, I can teach you how to do that. And by me teaching you that, and we work closely together, and then kind of things start to, you know, lead into something. And that's probably my doing, is that I'm going to kind of steering things in that direction. I'm not promising you anything, but like, you know, oh, well, I can get you some really good roofing jobs after all this is done. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that you have for me to teach you that you have to do this for me. I'm not saying that either. I'm not right. Making you any kind of promises. I'm doing exactly what I said, but I'm also using our friendship to get something out of it that so that's why I'm like, I'm not understanding here. I'm not saying that it's not wrong. I'm saying I'm not understanding how that works.
Yeah.
That's the part that I'm missing.
Most of what I understand from grooming is targeting minors or kids specifically. It's basically desensitizing them to sexual abuse through favors, through, you know, what have you.
Right.
Whether that's like, you know, buying them a game console or buying them a cell phone or whatever, and then just kind of building the kids' trust and then isolating the kids and desensitizing them. So as far as with adults, I really don't know how that works. It's pretty easy to spell out what it's happening when you're talking about the exploitation of children, but I really don't know how I would define it when it comes to adults.
Yeah, I said, I've only read little bits of things, and I need to, like I said, need to read this webpage. It's got all these accounts, from the people that were involved. But I kept seeing that word. I'm like, I know what that word means, but I don't know what it means in this context. And I was like, okay, so yeah, reserving any kind of like judgment. But I realized that what I recognize the definition to be doesn't fit within these parameters here. So there's something I'm missing. I just need to know exactly what it is.
Right.
I thought maybe you might have that.
Yeah, I'm actually doing some Googling as we speak, and I'm really not seeing a lot on adults. I mean, it's basically what I spelled out with kids. But
well, I was gonna say, obviously you're probably not gonna answer right here because we'd be on the phone way too long. But I was gonna say, look up the individual, and maybe that'll kind of show you. But I'll probably get it when I read the accounts, I'll be like, oh, okay, now I get it.
Yeah. Just target me. God, just text me the link. Don't target me. That's the first stage of grooming. Don't do that.
What's stage two?
I'm not gonna go into this on the podcast.
I've been at stage one for so long.
Grabs notepad, scribbles furiously. So we have been going for a while. Because this is all one big recording batch, I really don't know what's what as far as our episodes, but we've been recording for like 3 hours. So
yeah.
So this is probably a good jumping off point for an episode. This is probably a multi-parter at this point.
Unfortunately, it's not. Well, it was. I knew going into it was going to be a heavy topic, and I was still trying to, work some humor in there. But yeah, it's not a lot of humor in this one. But it's not really a lot of humor you can put into it, right?
Yeah, it's really not a funny topic. But the best thing about it being season 3 is that I fulfilled my promise to you about not talking about sex robots for the remainder of season 2.
I thought the season 2 was going to last a lot longer, and then I was like, you know what? We probably need to stop season 2 and take a break and start season 3.
Season 2's still longer than season 1 was, so.
It's true.
Yeah.
Can we go a little bit longer before we start talking about the automaton?
I will not talk about it for at least the next 2 episodes.
Because I'm going to tell you right now, when you do bring it up, I've got a rebuttal that you cannot refute.
I guess we'll see, but I'll give you 2 more episodes before I just find a way to disgustingly shoehorn it back into our topics of conversation.
Okay, I mean, you know what? Because I'm such a nice guy, I am even going to prepare you so that, so you can try to work up some kind of defense to it, but you can't. And really what I'm doing is I'm just stopping you right now from bringing up sex robots. because if you do, I'm going to bring this up and you're not going to have anything to say about it.
Oh, are you about to talk about the Anna Kendrick movie Dummy?
No, because, I mean, she's not having sex with it. She just finds that it's just a friend. Next time you want to bring it up and be like, oh, I don't understand, or blah, 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 and all that kind of stuff, I'm just going to remind you that if I had one, that you, even though you want to talk about it so much, how you don't like them, and, it's like, I would never have one, and blah, 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 that you'd want one just so, and you can't deny this, you'd want one just so we could take it and go, throw her off the roof! Door off the roof!
Yes, I can't deny that would be pretty amazing.
You would buy one just so we could do that. And if I had one, when the newest model came out, That's how you need to buy a new one. You're like, what do we do with the old one? I got an idea.
Bro, we're off the roof. That was an old model anyway.
That's right.
Yeah, when I was editing that Let's Watch, I didn't realize how long it took for us to actually get to that particular brand of the joke. Because every other time it was like, throw her off the bridge! So it took us a hot minute to find our true voice there.
I watched it with our commentary for like a good 40 minutes or so. And I was like, oh my god. Yeah, it took a minute to line it up too.
Mm-hmm.
Because I didn't start from the beginning. And then I was like, oh. Because then when it first happened, I was like, expecting to throw her off the roof. And I was like, no, wait. I was like, yeah, because he just picked her up and threw out the window before we even knew what happened.
Right.
And then he kissed the other girl later. And I was like, where's her off the roof? And I'm like, oh, there it is. Throw her off the roof. It was so great. Ah, that was beautiful.
All right. Well.
But, you know. I'm very grateful that that there was a lot of attention being brought to the things that are going on, and I said earlier, having to police somebody who should be policing themselves, and people not doing that, doing their job, and saying this guy or woman doesn't need to work here. That's wrong, but the fact that these people are being identified and saying, hey, look, we're not putting up with this anymore, I think it's fantastic. But you don't just treat the symptoms, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that, and you don't Once you find a quote unquote cure, you don't give the cure to people that aren't sick.
Right.
You know? It's like when you get the flu, and it's like, we're giving you a little bit of the virus so that your body can fight it and become immune. And it's like, but you also may, get a little sick, because of it, but you won't get the full pneumonia or whatever it is. Right? But for the most part, that's how you treat those kind of things. But you don't do that with everybody. Yeah. So if I'm not sick, don't ask me to take a cure. I don't know. I think we're in the interest of protecting people, we kind of forgetting the right way that we need to protect people, maybe?
Yeah, totally. I completely agree with that.
And again, I would say that just quote-unquote canceling somebody doesn't solve the problem.
Yeah, not even remotely.
And if I was in school and I was really bad at spelling, and I couldn't spell worth shit, man, and I can't read worth shit, right? You don't go to my parents and be like, well, we're kicking him out of school because he can't do the basic things, which is, read and write. So, yeah, bye. You're not allowed in school anymore. No, you work with them and try to figure out what's going on. But, oh, by the way, your child's dyslexic.
Right.
There's a fix for that. This can help them. Kind of think it's the same thing. You've got a problem, and just throwing you out on your ass or in the streets doesn't fix the problem. The only difference is that a child that's dyslexic doesn't know that they're dyslexic, as where someone's a piece of shit knows they're a piece of shit, and you just have to be willing to accept help or ask for it. And if not one of those things or interests you, there's a nice piece of curb outside that you can sit your ass on.
Yep.
I'm done.
Yeah, I'm sure that even as I'm speaking, people can hear the dogs barking in the background, but I'll try to get that silenced out. Anyways, yeah, I will bid everyone good night. I have been Acomi.
I have candy in my mouth. But it's a Zot, so...
Ooh, yes.
Yeah. I had to have one of those.
Yeah, Zots are amazing.
I, as always, in Turk182.
Yeah, thanks for giving us a listen, folks. It's kind of a weird way to kick off Season 3, but, yeah, it kind of weighed heavily on our minds, so...
Yeah. And, Yeah, I don't think I have anything. Oh, I think I cut my tongue on the Zot. Yeah.
Oh, that'll do it.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know why, understand why, like, the most delicious candy is always the one that's so deadly. Jolly Ranchers,
mm-hmm.
They'll slice your tongue up. Doesn't matter if it's like the little hard ones or if it's like the Jolly Rancher sticks. Oh, yeah. They'll cut you up like a prison shiv.
Oh, yeah. Zot,
same thing.
Yeah, they're awful.
It's so damn good. Yeah, with the day they start making candy-coated razor blades, my ass is in trouble.
They probably would be, like, super, super tasty, though.
They would be. Oh, my God. On the plus side, though, once I've, you know, officially cut my tongue off, though, I don't have anything to worry about. I'm like, well, shit. There's nothing stopping from eating them now. Well, actually, it would be like, nah.
Go swimming.
I like the red blade. All right, goodbye, everybody.
Bye, everybody.
All right there, folks, that was Our Moms Think We're Funny. Let's give them a hand.